morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Fatia Abubakar. I'm from a town called Maiduguri in northeast Nigeria, and I am an accidental photojournalist. I say accidental because I spent many years in medical college studying to be a nurse, and I also went on to study public health. And while I was a student in London studying for my master's, I became fascinated by health communications, and we had a class on using social media for health. And after that class, I decided it was very powerful for me, and I went on to learn how to be a photographer. I went on YouTube, I learned how to use the camera, I took a lot of pictures around London, and it was very therapeutic for me because I was clinically depressed and I had difficulties focusing in school because while I was studying, there was an ongoing conflict in my community and a deadly terrorist group called Boko Haram had been attacking our communities and destroyed almost all of the 27 regions of our state. And this had resulted in me becoming interested in researching the impact of the psychological impact of war on refugees within my school. And my research led me to something that for me was really very profound, which was adversity-activated development, a community becoming resilient because of the adversity they had faced and continuing to thrive even in the midst of a conflict. And so I went on to finished my research and I went back home. And what I saw when I went back home was exactly that, resilience. Our people were being bombed, being abducted, being killed, but they were still thriving, they were still focused on ensuring that they continued with their lives. Children were going to school, women were having weddings, people were going to the market. Even 1 hour after a bomb blast, you'd see people still going back to the market. And for me, that was something I decided to capture. The human spirit, its ability to bounce back from whatever it undergoes. And for me, that was something that I felt that the world needed to see. We see a lot of tragedy every day, but I felt like we also need to see the triumphs, especially in Africa, because we get so much coverage about devastation, disease, the destruction, but we don't see the ability of the human spirit to bounce back from all that it endures. So the focus of my project, I decided to title it Bruised But Not Broken, because I felt that my community is bruised, but it's not completely broken. Our spirit is not broken. So every day I go around and take pictures of people within my community and talk to them. How are you coping in this conflict? How are you able to pick up the pieces of your life and continue? So the project is on social media, and it has been ongoing for 4 years now. And I kind of take pictures and I post them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And people are amazed by what they see, and they're shocked that there is life even in the midst of all of that. So I'll be taking you through some of the imagery, and I'll be discussing some of them. This is one of the local communities. This is actually my mother's village, which had been bombed, and it was evacuated. And actually, it is almost like a ghost town now. People are being resettled, but it's still not back to what we knew. So most of the 27 local governments in our community look exactly like this. This was on a wall in one of the villages. I don't know who had written it, but it was called Boko Haram is Evil, and we feel the same in our community. And this is a series that I'm doing on young people within the community who had become fed up with the terrorism and had formed a vigilante group and were fighting together with the Nigerian military and going into villages and kind of fighting the war that is happening. And this is one of the positive images where I go around like seeing how people are using all kinds of therapeutic ways to cope within the conflict. And this was one of our first football games in 8 years, and the stadium was packed because people hadn't been able to play in such a long time, and I decided to go there and kind of capture that. And this was one of the series that I'd done about the abduction. I'm sure a lot of people know about the Chibok girls, but one thing that I felt that wasn't highlighted was the thousands of other girls who had also been abducted in every single community. So I titled it The Other Abducted Girls, and I was focusing on the other girls who weren't famous, like the Chibok girls, but also are enduring in camps and having to deal with the trauma of captivity. This was what I call the aging in a crisis, because a lot of what I see within my communities are focused on women and children. Yes, that's very important, but there was a less focus on geriatric care. You see a lot of struggling older people within the camps. There was nothing specifically focused on them, and I felt like that was really necessary. This, for me, is a special moment because this was one of the one time that we were able to go to compete in a festival where there's a horse riding. It's called the Durbar in Nigeria. We went all the way to Kaduna, and we were number two, which we're really excited about. And for me, this is something that I love, really, because every time I go to the camps, I really love children and kind of seeing them, despite everything, kind of having to, they're very exuberant, and that, as a photojournalist, cheers you up. They have this ability, like the Teflon tendency, they just have this ability to roll with the punches and find happiness. They make their own toys, they get plastic, and they make all kinds of different things. So for me, that's something that I really love. It makes me happy. And I enjoy being around children at that time. And something that I was really interested in was also ensuring that the visual storytelling continued within my community. So with the help of an organization who found me on Facebook, actually, USAID, we were able to train young people within our community because I felt like, you know, we had become statistics in a way. Every time there was breaking news, 10,000 died, 400,000 malnourished, there wasn't like a face to the conflict. We were victims of a conflict. There were no stories about survival. So I felt it was essential for us to show that. And the continuity was very important for me as well. If I'm unable to continue with that story, it's because, God forbid, we don't know what happens. I would like for young people in our community to pick up the camera, tell our stories, go into their communities, tell us what is happening. Just citizen journalism was what I focused on. So that was the aim of our workshop, and I'm going to play a short video of the end product of our workshop.
Just really depict what life is like beyond the conflict and how people have weddings, they go to school, they have businesses. So essentially, I try to show a counter narrative to what we're used to. I can't be the only one doing this. We have to have a community documenting our.
Well, thank you for listening, and I hope that we continue to do what we do and to be resilient. Even as people who work within communities, we know the toll it takes on us. So for you also, I'd like to say be a little bruised, but not broken. Thank you.